physicists and astrophysicists really didn't know whether or not our solar system was unique. By that, I mean that we knew that these stars were suns, like our suns, bigger and smaller, but we thought that we might be the only one that has planets around it. In the 90s, astrophysicists made a startling discovery that it turns out that they were able to actually see that there are the other stars out there have planets also. This was highly significant. These are called extrasolar planets for that reason. This was highly significant because if there are other planets out there, then there could be a distribution of them. In fact, we have now observed that there are some planets that are literally too close to their suns to have life. There are planets that are too far away, too cold to have life. And physicists being creative have a name for a group of planets that they've discovered fairly recently. And you can probably guess from the name what these planets, the name, they're called Goldilocks planets. And these Goldilocks planets are planets that are orbiting just right. In other words, they might be able to support life. Now, the importance of that to what I was saying is the fact that now physicists, this has nothing to do with UFOs. Now the scientific community believes that the universe is probably teeming with life. The difference between that and the UFOologists is the fact that we're not so sure yet that any of that life has found us. You know, whereas the people in UFOs believe that that life has actually, you know, found us. However, the thing is that if there's life out there, and we believe that there is, that means there's also a distribution of that. There'll be planets with life more primitive than us, planets with life about where we are, planets that are more advanced. That means that these more advanced planets probably have already developed time travel and have turned on their machine thousands of years ago, let's say 10,000 years ago. Their machine has the same limitation that Charles was mentioning, that is to say that when you turn the device on, it's the device that creates the effect. So let's suppose I turned it on today and I leave it on for 100 years. Then someone 100 years can come back 75 years, 50 years, all the way back to the time the machine was turned on. But it's the machine that creates the effect, so they can't go earlier than that, okay? So that means that once the first time machine is turned on, people from the future will be able to visit their past, okay? But if we visit an extraterrestrial planet that has life that has turned it on, let's say 10,000 years ago, then we could actually use their device to travel to our distant past, okay? And that is something that's an exciting and possible notion, okay? Whether or not that'll happen in my lifetime, who knows? But so to me, it's like this spark that, from a terrestrial standpoint, there's that limitation for me, but from the standpoint of time travel itself in general, when we're looking at the universe as a whole, it is possible that eventually we will be able to visit even our distant past, ancient Rome and ancient Egypt.